Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Richard Poe, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Religion, Myth, and Magic, the Anthropology of Religion. Your professor will be Susan Johnston. Professor Johnston teaches a variety of courses in anthropology and archaeology, including the archaeology of the Celtic peoples, archaeological myths and mysteries, and the anthropology of religion at George Washington University in Washington, D.C. Professor Johnston has carried out archaeological research in Ireland since the 1980s, when she did her PhD dissertation on Irish rock art of the Neolithic and Bronze Age. She has also done archaeological work in such varied places as India, England, and Rhode Island. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites and a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students. And now we begin Religion, Myth, and Magic, the Anthropology of Religion. Lecture 1. What is religion?
I've called this course Religion, Myth, and Magic, but it mostly focuses on the idea of religion. Religion is something that we find in all cultures, and we're going to look at it from that point of view. I'm going to take an anthropological perspective, which looks at religion cross-culturally, that is, how religion is expressed in many different cultures. The interesting thing about religion from the perspective of studying humans is that every culture that we know of has some aspect of it or aspects of it that we can call religion. They are hugely varied. There are thousands of religions and many variants within religions. Some cultures have a single religion, some cultures have many religions, but in that sense, religion forms a kind of human universal. Religion is also very much deeply connected to culture. And so consequently, the two are very closely intertwined in the sense that one connects with the other, one reflects the other, et cetera. And we'll talk more about that in a little bit. So what we're going to look at is how religion is expressed in different cultures, what some of the similar themes are, how we can try to understand the variation that we find in religion, and also how we can try to understand the commonalities. I'm going to talk in a little bit about the general notion of religion. We're going to look at some of the previous definitions of religion, how religion has been understood by other people who have studied it, and try to come up with a working definition, something that will allow us to identify a particular phenomenon in different cultures. In the next lecture, we're going to look specifically at religious specialists. All cultures have people that are particularly charged with doing religious things. Things that are, well, specialized in terms of religious notions. Sometimes those people are religious specialists for their job. Sometimes it's something that they only do part-time. It kind of depends on the culture. But we'll look at some of the ways to understand, again, what is common and what is different about religious specialists. The next thing we'll talk about is mythology. Mythology is also a subject that has been studied in a variety of different ways from a variety of different perspectives. It's a kind of funny topic because on the one hand, we have a sort of common way of using the word, which means something that isn't true, it's a myth. On the other hand, the way mythology works in cultures, it actually is enormously important. It tends to touch on things that are very significant in a culture and even define a culture. So we will look at mythology and what we can learn about cultures through analyzing their mythology. Then we're going to talk about symbols. The study of symbols is an enormous undertaking. Symbols are pervasive in human culture, and there is an entire field called semiotics, which is specifically about studying symbols. However, we're going to look at symbols more in the context of religion, where the use of symbols, the manipulation of symbols, can be enormously powerful. Then the next two discussions we're going to have focus specifically on ritual. Ritual is the most visible aspect of religion in some ways. It's what people do in the context of their religion, how they act, how they behave. We're going to look first at what ritual is. One of the interesting things about ritual from a cross-cultural perspective is that even if you have no idea what the ritual is, what it's doing, you still recognize it as a ritual. You can walk into another culture and say, yeah, they're doing something. It's a ritual. And so what we want to look at specifically is how we can characterize rituals. What is it about ritual that allows us to identify it even if we have no idea what the ritual is about? Then we're going to turn specifically to the function of ritual. One of the things that's important about rituals is that rituals accomplish something. They do something specific. And so what we want to look at is some of the things that ritual is intended to accomplish. What is its function? Next, we're going to turn to what I've called the non-human world. One of the issues that we're going to revisit a lot here is terminology, language, how we define certain things, what we call them. And I've worked a lot trying to figure out exactly what to call this, but I ended up with the non-human world. But you might be more familiar with the idea of supernatural. And there are various reasons why I think that term is not terribly successful, and I'll talk more about that later. But one of the features about religion that is central to it, and again, is if not universal, then very near universal, is that humans perceive their world as only being partly about the physical world, that there is another world, a non-human world, that exists above it or with it or alongside it that is different, that is composed of beings that are non-human and so on. And so we will look at how those things are expressed in a variety of different ways. The next two lectures will be about religions in the past. One of the interesting questions is where religion comes from. If religion is something that all humans have, then what does that say in terms of its place in human society? Where did it come from? Why do we all have religion? There are some interesting ideas having to do with the biology of religion, which is a strange concept, but nevertheless, we can talk a little bit about that. Is it partly about our physical makeup? And then we also want to look at how we can see, in terms of archaeology, the beginnings of religion. One of the tricky aspects of this is trying to recognize religion when we see it. And so we will look at it from that perspective. In addition, we also want to think about the possibility of others of our ancestors, beings who are not technically human in the modern sense, such as Neanderthals, who have done some things which could theoretically be indicative of religion. So we have to think about what that means, how we would recognize that, and what that has to do with the origins of human religion. Then we're going to turn to the analysis of ancient religions. This is an enormously tricky subject, as I just said, partly because for most of human history, we did not have writing, and therefore we don't have direct access to the ideological component, to the part of religion that is in our minds, the beliefs that we have that constitute religion. And so we have to rely on the physical remains for most of our history that people left behind in the practice of religion. And so from that point of view, we want to consider what we can learn about ancient religions, what can we say and what can't we say, and again, what that has to do with our understanding of modern human religion. Then we're going to turn to a series of topics that focus on some of the aspects of religion that are significant and, frankly, that I find interesting. One of the first ones is the notion of death. Death is a human universal. It is something that will happen to all of us eventually, sadly to say. And so religion deals with death pretty much in every culture that we know of. Death is something that is fundamentally religious. It raises questions that only religion can answer. And so we need to look at death from a religious perspective. What is it about death? How have cultures dealt with death cross-culturally? And how is it similar and different in terms of our own understandings? We'll then turn to magic and witchcraft, one of the more exotic aspects from a modern perspective, from a modern Western perspective. in terms of how these fit with an understanding of religion. There are many, many cultures that see notions of illness, misfortune, things like that, as being the product of magical acts by people with ill intent. And so what we want to look at is how those understandings work, and again, cross-culturally, how we can understand those phenomena. Are they really fundamentally different from the way we would see the world in U.S. culture or not? We also want to look at religion and gender. Gender is the social understanding of what it means to be male and female. That is, how does religion understand maleness? How does religion understand femaleness? And rather interestingly, what other kinds of ways of understanding gender are there? There are cultures, for example, who understand gender very differently. There are cultures who understand there to be more than two genders. And so how is that understood in terms of religion, in terms of social understandings of male and female, and so on? Then we're going to look at what I've called new religious forms. That is, while we've talked about the origins of religion in the misty past, there are still religions that are now forming or religions that are changing significantly. And so what we're interested in looking at here is, where do those things come from? How do new religious forms appear, and what are the social situations that those religions are a response to? And then finally, we're going to look at religion and politics. This is a topic that has been much discussed in U.S. culture lately, but the idea that religion and politics are or should be separate is not an idea that has any time depth. For the vast majority of human history, it was simply assumed that religion and politics were one, and that political interests and religious interests were essentially the same. What we want to look at then is, in our modern society, where there seems to be a more common notion that religion and politics should be separate, where do religion and politics come together? How do religion and politics touch each other, influence each other, and those kinds of issues? Now, if we're going to talk about religion, we need to think about some kind of a definition. If this is something that all humans have, and if we can recognize it in all human cultures, at least in some sense, then there ought to be general characteristics that all religions in all cultures share. And to some extent, this is true. However, to coin a phrase, the devil's in the details. Because there is so much variation in religion, it is often very difficult to talk about something that defines all religions. There's a tendency, for example, for many writers to talk about all religions and yet focus predominantly on large world religions like Judaism and Islam, or religions that come from cultures that are essentially similar, even though they're different in some ways, cultures that are urban-based, state-level societies, and so on. So what we want to do is try to broaden that out and think about religion in a much more generalized kind of way. Now, people have tried to define religion throughout the study of religion. One of the early ones was a man named Edward Tyler, who was an early student of culture. He kept it very simple. He defined religion in 1871 as a belief in spiritual beings. And to some extent, I think that's true, but I think you would probably recognize at this point that that's not the sum total of it. You can't encompass all religions that way. James Frazer, who is famous for writing a monumental work called The Golden Bough, which became a classic of the late 19th and early 20th centuries, basically took the same tack, referring to it as, quote, a propitiation or conciliation of powers superior to man, which are believed to direct and control the course of nature and of human life. That's also not a bad definition in some ways, although it does assume that other cultures necessarily believe in some sort of other world that controls their lives. And I don't think that's necessarily accurate. What both of these men did was focus largely on what religion is rather than what religion does. that approach is very difficult precisely because there is such a staggering diversity in religious forms. And therefore, trying to focus on what it is ultimately self-defeating. For example, we'll talk more about non-human beings later on, but not all cultures believe that those beings have a significant impact on human life, have to be propitiated and worshipped and things like that. One of the more famous comments about religion was that of Karl Marx, who made his now famous statement in 1843 in one of his books, which we have to really quote in full. It's often cited simply as religion is the opiate of the masses, but that's not entirely accurate. If you read the whole sentence, what he says is a little bit different. He says, quote, "Religion is the sigh of the oppressed creature, the heart of a heartless world, and the soul of soulless conditions. It is the opium of the people." That sounds a little bit different than just saying it's a way to drug people into mindless sensibility. What he was trying to say instead was that religion served to make the world a more bearable place. Now, I have to say that it doesn't necessarily mean that Marx was a big fan of religion. In actual fact, the reason that he thought people needed to have the world be a more bearable place is precisely because he thought society was a bad thing, that society as he had experienced it was not good, and that people at the top, in effect, tried to fool people through things like religion into thinking that their world was okay. So I wouldn't exactly go so far as to say that Marx thought religion was a good thing. I think probably it would be fair to say instead that Marx thought that religion was something that people used for better or worse to make themselves feel better. Now, by contrast, Emil Durkheim, who's another famous theorist of religion, argued that society for him was constantly in danger of flying apart. His view of things, particularly from a French perspective, he was a French sociologist, was that society probably needed mechanisms to keep it together, that without those mechanisms, society would fragment. And so he saw religion specifically as being about holding society together, that it related to sacred things and that it united people into a community, that it made them feel that they wanted to be part of something. It sort of gave them a reason for uniting together. Now, the problem with that, of course, as later writers pointed out, is that religion clearly does not always do that. Sometimes it divides people. Sometimes it itself can cause trouble. And so the idea that religion always functions somehow to bring people together, to give them a sense of community, isn't entirely accurate. More recent versions of the attempt to define religion have broadened the idea out much more. And in many ways, they have their pros and cons as well. I'm not going to sort of recite a whole list of definitions if I haven't already. But what I would say in general is that in some ways, most definitions of religion fall short largely because there are too many exceptions to the rule. So where does that leave us? Well, the definition that I'm planning to use here is one that was used by an anthropologist named Arjuna Potterai. I don't think he actually published it anywhere, but it was the definition he gave us when he taught the course that I took in graduate school. And I've used it ever since because it seems to me that it's a nice balance between trying to understand what religion is and trying to understand what religion does. His definition, which I've adapted just a little bit to reduce some of the jargon, is that religion is a system of beliefs and behaviors that formulates and answers questions that are important, recurrent, and must be answered. Now, if you break that up into its components, into the pieces of it, it kind of makes sense. First, it emphasizes that religion is composed of both beliefs and behaviors. In other words, there is a component that is ideological, that is in our minds, that is what we believe. It's how we think about the world and so on. There is also a component that is behaviors, the things that we do because of those beliefs. So therefore, the two work together. Beliefs cause us to behave in certain ways. the ways that we behave feed back into the way we see the world. So it's beliefs and behaviors. In addition, religion is a system. What a system means is that it's embedded in a network. It's something that has a series of moving parts, all of which are related to each other, so that some parts change, causing other parts to change. In this case, the system is culture, that religion is a system within the larger system of culture. And so it tends to mirror culture in certain important ways. For example, if culture is hierarchical, then religion tends to be hierarchical. If culture tends to be highly male-dominated, then religion tends to be highly male-dominated. They're not necessarily exactly the same, and there are complications which we will talk about in various ways later on. But the idea is that changes in one part of the system cause changes in the other part of the system. So when culture changes, religion changes, and vice versa. It's a feedback, in a sense. It's a system. So in terms of what it is, religion is a system of beliefs and behaviors. The second part of the definition talks about what religion does. Now, according to a Potteri, what it does is formulate and answer particular kinds of questions. Now, this is kind of an interesting take on religion. I think most people probably would find familiar the idea that religion answers questions. This is something that's very, very common in terms of how we think about religion in U.S. society. It's something that provides meaning. It's something that tells us things we need to know, and so on. What was interesting about a Potteri's version is that religion also formulates those questions. That is, it asks the questions. And they aren't just any questions in that sense. They're questions that have particular kinds of characteristics. The first thing is that they're important. Religion answers questions that are considered to be crucial. Now, religion may also answer other kinds of questions. That's entirely possible. But the one thing that all religions seem to share is that they address really crucial questions. They're questions whose answers are significant in some way, things that are really important, things that we need to know. They're also what he called recurrent, which is, okay, a jargony word, but basically what it means is they're things that come up again and again, and this happens in a variety of different ways. Religion can raise the same questions in a single culture again and again and again. That is, every generation tends to ask the same questions. Things like, what happens when we die? Where did the world come from? Why are men and women different? These are all questions that every generation needs to know. It's also recurrent in the sense that these questions are asked over and over again cross-culturally. That is, they're questions that all cultures seem to want to know. They're things that people seem to be concerned with regardless of the specific society that they live in. So the questions are important, they are recurrent, and in something which sort of overlaps this but introduces another series of ideas, they're questions that must be answered. In that sense, this talks about a kind of psychological well-being. They're questions that we need to have some kind of answer to, in the sense that if we don't have answers, there's a sense of psychological unease. They're questions that we need to know about in order to live our lives in a satisfying fashion. So what a Potteri's definition essentially emphasizes is it's a system of beliefs and behaviors, and it answers and formulates questions of a particular nature. Why do bad things happen? Why are people different from each other? And so on. Now, there may be other aspects to religion. This is not, as a definition, intended to encompass everything that religion could possibly do. But rather, what it's intended to do is pinpoint those things that all religions minimally do. So there may be religions that deal with very trivial issues and so on, but basically all religions do at least these things. Now, I like this definition partly for that reason. That is, it's broad enough to talk about a variety of different phenomena. I also like it because it doesn't necessarily talk about any notion of the supernatural. I think this idea is often difficult for people who are experienced with Western cultures to think about, because for us, a central idea in the religions that most of us are familiar with is a notion of God, a deity, something like that. But the fact is, as I said, while all cultures have notions of non-human individuals, not all cultures see them as deities in that sense. And so this definition unhooks religion from the need for some kind of deity. And so I think it's more useful in different kinds of cultural settings for that reason. Now, it's usually at this point when I'm talking about this in class that a student sticks up his or her hand and says, "But Professor Johnston, if you use this definition, wouldn't it apply to science too?" And what I would say is this definition does, in fact, in a sense, encompass science. Now, let me be clear here. I am not saying that science and religion are the same thing. They're clearly not, any more than Quakerism and Jainism are the same thing. What I am saying is that what we conventionally call religion and what we think about as science are both, in a more general sense, kinds of belief systems. They're ways of viewing the world that make certain assumptions about the world and therefore have a series of beliefs and that suggest a certain series of behaviors as an outcome of those beliefs. For science, there are certain assumptions at the base of it. There is an assumption that there is a physical world, that everything in the world can be known, that physical world is separate from our reality, that the physical world is predictable, that is, it follows what we think about as laws, in the sense that we know if we drop a penny, it will hit the floor because of gravity. And so in that sense, there is a physical world that is knowable, that is predictable, and that is independent of our perceptions of it. Now, to some extent, those are things that have to be assumed. We can't really prove that. And so at its base, science is based on certain beliefs, a notion that there is a particular kind of world out there. Now, beyond that, there are certain behaviors which science then suggests come out of those beliefs. And we can talk about things like the scientific method and things of that nature. In a sense, those are the behaviors that come out of the science system, how science goes about measuring the world and so on. Science also clearly formulates and answers questions. There are certain questions that science doesn't touch, such as, is there a God? That's not a scientific question because God is not a scientific concept. And so in that sense, science does formulate certain questions and then answer them. That's the heart of the scientific method, proposing hypotheses and so on. So in that sense, science is structured in a way that is similar to religion. It's also the case that many of the questions that science touches on are important recurrent questions. Not all of them, but some of them. Now, again, I want to say very clearly that I'm not suggesting that science and religion are the same. But what I am suggesting is that we can think about science and religion as being two versions of a larger thing which we can think of as a belief system or a worldview. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean that science and religion have to be at odds. The human mind is an incredibly flexible thing, and the vast majority of people manage quite happily to combine the two in the sense that they accept science in certain parts of their lives and they accept religion in other parts of their lives. Clearly, this is the case in most belief systems. People manage to combine all sorts of things without experiencing that as a contradiction. So in that sense, largely what we're talking about in the context of religion is really that religion is a kind of belief system. It's a way of seeing the world that shares certain things. How we understand that from a cross-cultural perspective then is what forces us, in a sense, to step back and be more general about how we think about it and to talk about things that include even a notion of science. Now, we're not really going to talk about science anymore, but I thought I would put it in there because I think it's interesting to think about from that point of view. Mostly what we are going to focus on is things that most of us would conventionally understand to be religion. Cross-culturally, the way these questions are thought about, the way that the questions are answered, the rituals that people engage in are enormously varied. There is an enormous amount of variation in terms of how these things are worked out. And so we will look at some of the variation as a way to understand how it is that people cross-culturally have managed to formulate and answer those questions. What we're concerned with here is both what humans share cross-culturally in terms of religion, what it is that is fundamentally human about religion, and how it is that we vary, because this is sort of the heart of anthropology. If we take an anthropological perspective, what we are interested in first is how people differ. What are the different ways? What is the range of variation that people have thought about the other world and so on? However, ultimately, what we are also interested in is what people share, how those things are similar. And so from an anthropological perspective, if we look at religion as a fundamentally human phenomenon, what we're interested in is using that to get at the question of the human condition, human experience, how humans experience the world and how it is that we incorporate those experiences in the framework of a religious understanding. Now, what we will talk about next, then, is those particular individuals who are specifically charged with carrying out religious experiences, because cross-culturally, there are always people for whom religion is their special skill. And so that is where we will turn to next.
This ends Lecture 1. Religion, Myth, and Magic, The Anthropology of Religion. Lecture 2. Religious Specialists.
Since religion is part of the larger culture and something that typically touches on fundamental aspects of experience, then it makes sense that we would have people who are specialists in religion. That is, people for whom there is special knowledge, special skills, things of that nature. People who are specifically charged with the carrying out of religion in day-to-day life. This is because religion potentially involves enormous power. That sounds a little melodramatic, but when we're talking about basic issues of human life, then it only follows logically that those aspects have the potential to affect human life in significant ways. And so we have people whose skills, experience, personal aspects, personal qualities make them particularly appropriate for the carrying out of religion. Now, there are, again, as with religion, there are a million different kinds of religious specialists, and indeed, in a given religion, there may be more than one kind of specialist. So, again, trying to categorize them can be a tricky thing. One thing that we can say is they are, of course, connected to the larger culture. And so in that sense, if the culture is hierarchical, then religious specialists tend to be hierarchical and so on. Society's ideas about gender are often reflected in religious notions and so on. But beyond this, it gets increasingly complicated. One particularly useful way of thinking about specialists, therefore, was proposed by an anthropologist named Victor Turner. Now, he used the term priest and shaman to anchor two ends of a continuum as basic categories. I don't think those terms are particularly useful, largely because they have a whole bunch of other associations that go with them. So rather than looking at it that way, using those terms, we simply think about it in terms of a continuum of religious specialists, which are probably most usefully thought of as full-time versus part-time. So therefore, we're going to look at this continuum from that point of view. At one end, we have what we can think of as full-time religious specialists, and at the other end, we can think of as part-time religious specialists. Now, at the full-time end, individuals who are specialists like this are typically institutionalized. That means that there is a structure in society, an institution, a place, a role that is independent of the individual that will always be filled by somebody. The position exists because of the larger institution. In that sense, it's the person's job. This is the end that Turner's priests belong in. Probably the majority of people that we think of as being religious specialists would belong here. Priests, ministers, rabbis, imams, things like that. They come out of a larger institution, a church, a temple, those sorts of things. They also, because they are trained by the institution, they tend to be much more closely defined in terms of their role. It's defined by the institution in a specific way, and therefore variation in what they can do may in fact be somewhat limited. They have certain parameters that they have to perform within. Turner also noted that people at this end typically have formal training. They are specifically trained by the institution in a formal setting. There is usually some kind of separate institution which is specifically charged with doing this kind of training so that they can carry out the specific rituals and activities according to the proper religious protocols. In that sense, we can think in terms of typical religious services in the U.S., something like Catholic Mass, for example, which is essentially the same every time it's done. Or maybe a better way to think about it is that there's a core set of activities that has to happen in order for it to be considered a legitimate Mass. That comes about because priests are trained in a particular formal setting to do things that way. Turner also noted that at this end of the continuum, religious specialists tend to be oriented towards the other world. They tend to do what they do because the other world requires it or needs it in some sense. Again, if we use our example of Mass, in theory at least, priests perform Mass every day regardless of whether anybody actually shows up to attend. Things like marriage ceremonies, for example, are done because they are required by a deity or something along those lines. And so a religious specialist at the full-time end of the continuum is somebody who does what they do because of the needs of the other world as opposed to this world. Now, they may still address the needs of this world, but their fundamental calling, in a sense, is from the other world. Now, in that sense, then, they communicate with that other world largely through ritual. Ritual performs a kind of mediation. It's the focus point between this world and the next. And so ritual is done precisely to communicate with the other world at the behest of the other world because of the specific formal training that these individuals have received. In that sense, then, as I said, these are the individuals that I think are most familiar to us. They are people whose full-time job, in a sense, is being a religious specialist, and they do what they do in the context of ritual, specifically at the behest of the other world, in order to form a kind of contact point between this world and the other world. From our perspective, individuals at the other end of the continuum are far more exotic. These are people who do not inhabit a formal institutionalized role. Rather, it's much more individually defined. People decide they want to be, let's say, a shaman because they feel so motivated, but if nobody feels so motivated, there is no shaman in your community. So in that sense, there's no specific institutionalized role. There's a socially defined role, but there's no institution that supports it. Typically, then, since there is no formal institution, there is no standardized formal training for people at this end. It's much more likely to be carried out in the context of something like an apprenticeship, and therefore you learn from your mentor, your teacher, what it is you are supposed to be doing. And therefore, while there will be similarities between, say, you and the person who taught you, there may not be as many similarities between you and other practitioners. So it's far more likely to be idiosyncratic. There's much more flexibility at this end, much more variation in that sense. These individuals, as I said, are also typically part-time in the sense that most of the time they are doing something else. They're mostly doing what everybody else is, getting food, living their daily lives, and so on. But in various contexts, they may be called upon to do specific religious things. In that sense, they therefore are more oriented towards the community. They perform their religious role at the request of the community rather than at the requests of the other world. If people need healing, for example, they may come to this kind of religious specialist. If people need to communicate with the spirits of the other world and so on. So in that sense, at this end of the continuum, you have people who are more likely to be part-time, who are not institutionalized, whose roles are far more flexible and varied than at the other end. Now, one of the most probably unfamiliar and exotic aspects of practitioners at that end of the continuum is that they tend to interact with the other world directly. That is, they communicate personally with spirits of the other world. They may visit that other world directly in spirit form themselves, but whatever the specific medium, they usually communicate directly with the other world rather than through the medium of ritual. Now, this communication is often done through the medium of what we call trance. The concept of trance is a very complicated one, and it is a hotly debated one in anthropology and psychology and the various other ologies. There's no real consensus as to what exactly trance is, and indeed, there is no real consensus as to whether it even exists as a separate state. There is some research from a while ago that suggests that people who go into trance, in fact, are in a different state of consciousness, like sleeping versus waking versus reverie versus imagination and so on. There are other people who have argued that there is no such measurable state and that a trance, in a sense, is a performance. It is something that people do because of cultural expectation. Now, I'm not about to render judgment on which it is, but I will say that from an anthropological point of view, what is clear to me is that people who are in trance think they are in a different state. And so from that point of view, that's the more interesting way of looking at it. And so we will sort of proceed as if a trance state exists, even if we can't necessarily say that we can measure it objectively. Now, trance is usually induced by various kinds of intense experiences. It is often induced by rhythmic actions, such as dancing, chanting, drumming. Indeed, I might be able to put you into a trance if I did this just the right way, but I won't try. This is often prolonged. That is, people will drum for an extended period of time and then go into a trance. They will dance for long periods of time and so on. It may also be induced by extreme physical states, such as exhaustion or pain, so that people who are, for example, dancing for literally days at a time, who are physically exhausted, may enter trance that way. People often will enter trance through painful stimulus, through hurting themselves in one way or the other, or exposing themselves to pain. Trance may also be induced by artificial substances, that is, hallucinogenic drugs and things like that. I think most people would probably argue that this is a rather different kind of undertaking than the trance which is generated by personal experience. However, I will comment that cross-culturally, the use of hallucinogenic substances is not uncommon and is often worked into the framework of religious experience in ways that may be good or bad, depending on your particular perspective. Going back to the physical means of entering trance, there are a variety of different cultural examples we could talk about, but it is experienced as a kind of ecstatic state. For example, the Native American group called the Ogallala, who are a subgroup of the group sometimes known as the Sioux, perform something called the Sun Dance. In this particular ritual, skewers are attached to ropes at one end, and then the skewers are inserted into the flesh around a man's pectoral muscles, so into his chest and into his back. Then various means are used to tear the skewers out. Sometimes the man is suspended from the ceiling and he bounces up and down. They may attach a bison skull to one end of the ropes, etc. But whatever means is done, the individual dances with these skewers in his body until they tear out. So here we have an example of something that is a combination of an extreme physical state, that is, it hurts, and probably exhaustion and other things, at which point the individual then enters a kind of trance state, which is the goal of the experience. In another example, the Dobe people of southern Africa traditionally carry out healing rituals. The beliefs that underlie these rituals are that there is a substance in the body, which they call num, which boils up when an individual dances. So the person dances for days at a time, or at least hours, and this substance boils up, then the individual has access to it and can use it to heal people, again, in a kind of trance state. Among the Aguarana people of Peru, they ingest a substance called ayahuasca, which is, again, a hallucinogenic substance, and enter trance that way, at which point then they can see spirits in the other world, communicate with them, and so on. Whatever means is used in a culture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.